Good morning, Mayor DeBlasio and Chancellor Farina. Congratulations on 50 years of service to our children in education. Education is very important to me. That's why I ran for the community school board in District 17. At that time, we had the fifth best school in New York State, the Crown School for Law and Journalism. As time moves on, I'm senator from Brownsville. I represent Sunset Park, Gowanus, Park Slope, Prospect Heights, Crown Heights, and beautiful Brownsville. So I cover a diverse area. And I've been working with the CSA, the UFT. They've been doing a phenomenal job in educating our kids. But one school in particular, and many schools, but one I'll point out to you, the Brooklyn New School, a very prominent school, Principal Anna Allen Brook, is concerned that the new policies with the DOE are, she has to tell kids from Crown Heights and Bed-Stuy they cannot attend her school anymore due to the policies that are being put forth by the DOE. But kids from Williamsburg in the more affluent areas can. So as we see gentrification happening in our schools, the policies are sometimes having an adverse effect on the kids who are the best and brightest coming from minority neighborhoods, really having no options moving forward. So I just wanted to put that out there. I'm also the ranker for the Mental Health Committee. And what we noticed, I have an advisory committee, is that teachers don't have to take a class in mental health to identify. We know at a young age, young children exhibit maybe mental disabilities, that if they're addressed at an early age, they could be helped rather than moving forward. So myself and Assemblyman Crespo have introduced the mental health bill, which is S6234, which will require teachers to identify behavioral issues versus mental issues. So a child is not continuously suspended because the underlying mental issue is not addressed. Myself, my parents were divorced, I started acting out and fighting. But no one took the time to say what's going on in your life. And I think we need more of that holistic approach. Also being in Brownsville, statistically, the school reading scores have gone down under Mayor control. PS 284 from 22% under 6%. PS 218 from 18.9% to under 6%. PS 73 from 18% to under 5%. So what we're seeing in Brownsville is a reduction in the reading scores. I'm not sure, is that because of the increase in the homeless shelters? But seeing those scores, we started the campus in Brownsville. And the campus is 42 community-based organizations working with three schools to have technology and wellness centers with the Brooklyn Public Libraries.
Senator, would you be kind enough, because you're raising a number of issues, could we just pause for a moment and address those, and then we'll continue to answer anything else you have?
Right.
On the point about the last point, I'll work backward a little bit quickly. I know the Chancellor wants to offer her thoughts. There is no question, as I said, that we are dealing with a challenge in many communities of homelessness by families that did not used to exist. So you're absolutely right. This is an X factor in the equation. Almost 40,000 of the 58,000 people in shelter right now in New York City are family members, parents and children in families. That is putting a stress on particular districts in particular. That's why we're trying to add resources and approaches to address that. Now, but I would not agree with the idea that because some schools might have had some problems, that suggests that overall the strategies that we're putting in place aren't working, because I think the overwhelming evidence is that there's movement forward in the school system.
Oh no, you're doing a great job, but we can always just fine tune it a little bit.
There's no question, we have a lot to do, and I want to note, that's why I raised the Single Shepherd Initiative, for example, which Brownsville will be one of the leading edge areas for. Mm-hmm. This is trying to change the rules of the game entirely to say that a family and a young person will have support, direct, consistent support. The same exact individual will be with them from sixth grade all the way to 12th grade to help deal with any of the issues that come up, keep that child in the right place on their path forward. So we're making a number of investments, as I mentioned, the investments in the shelters. There's no question, when I talk about equity and excellence,
right. That
is a living, breathing idea that whenever you or anyone else identifies an area where we're not seeing sufficient equity, we need to go right at that. That's why we're working to change the numbers on the Fair Student Funding formula, et cetera. But I would say the broad strokes on graduation rate, on test scores, although as you know, I believe in multiple measures, test scores are only one indication, but we have so many pieces of evidence that something is moving across all communities. Right basic plan, a lot more to do, and a lot more fine-tuning, as you say. On mental health, I want to, first of all, I thank you for your focus on it.
I want to thank your wife also.
Well, that's where I was going to go.
Drive NYC, yes.
I thank my wife every day.
Okay.
And
that's a very wise position.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. You're right. I came to that realization early in marriage, sir.
Yeah. So did I.
I also know that our anniversary is May 14th, and it's right. 22 years. So I wanted to just know I'm prepared. When we looked at the mental health challenges of the city, Charlene rightfully decided we needed to literally create a system. We have, you know, a healthcare system, mm-hmm. but that means physical health.
Right.
We do not have a mental health system.
Right.
The audacity of what she's doing, I have immense respect for it, is she is saying with her Thrive NYC plan that we're going to create from scratch effectively. We're going to pull together a bunch of pieces that exist but are not a system, and create a system, give it the resources it needs. But the schools are a crucial piece of this. The 130 community schools, for example, all have mental health as one of the components that we're going to be adding into them. We believe that mental health services need to be available early
right.
to maximize exactly what you said, catching the difference between something that might be a temporary challenge and something that's a more profound challenge that needs to be addressed. And that's one of many things we'll do on mental health at the school level. So I just wanted you to, I appreciate your focus, and we want to work with you and Assemblyman Crespo, but we think you're exactly on the right track here. We think we have to focus on mental health in the school system if we're going to both help children learn, but also, God forbid, the tragedies we see that happen in adulthood in so many cases. How many people are in Rikers Island? How many people are homeless? How many people are unemployed because their mental health needs were not addressed early? So that's core to what we want to do. Finally, I'll pass to the chancellor on the question of the Brooklyn New School or any other school.
Right.
Again, our equity imperative is we do not want to see any formula that advantages one group over another, particularly folks who are privileged over folks who are less privileged. Right. A lot of exciting things are happening in the school system now to bring all different kinds of kids into the same school. A lot of new approaches are being innovated under Chancellor Farina. But if there is something, and she knows Brooklyn New School quite well for years, if there's something there that's happened that's causing an inadvertent outcome, we obviously want to work on that. So
I just want to thank your wife, the First Lady. I met with her a year and a half ago, and she had this initiative for Thrive NYC and for mental health. And she actually came to our district last week, yeah. And so I thank her for being in the forefront and putting it out there. So part of the campus and part of the mental health bill was your wife taking the initiative and bringing it to the forefront. So I want to thank her for that.
Thank you. I'll tell her. I appreciate that, yes. Senator.
I think, first of all, with the specificity of Brooklyn New School, it's one of our pro schools. So Anna has a lot of leeway in how she does her lottery, because it is a lottery school. It's not a zone school. And she was one of the beginning people to do a pros initiative.
Right.
And we actually put out this year that other schools who want to replicate her pros initiative for diversity are free to do so. And so she is one of the guiding lights on that issue. I want to be clear that, you know, we keep putting more and more on the teacher's plate and asking teachers to take more courses on more things. And one of the things that I think we really need to stress is that this training has to be part of the teacher education college experience. If you're going to train to be
yes.
a teacher,
it is.
That you need to have a certain amount of courses and credits. And we're working with the CUNY system to see how they can infuse some of this as part of their teacher training so that we don't have to play catch up when they first go into our schools. The other commitment is, and we started last year and continued this year, to increase the number of guidance counselors, not to work just with families and children, but to work with teachers. As a principal, I know one of the first things I did is have my guidance counselors meet on a weekly basis with all my first year teachers, because they're falling apart. They're just babies themselves. They need to have their hands held. They need to be trained. And what do you do when a child cries in a class, or child comes to school who you think may have been abused, and how do you handle that correctly? So there needs to be a lot of training. But I think added to that, and going back specific to the districts that you talked about, we can't measure reading scores as a whole school. You have to measure progress child by child. Because what's happening in a lot of our schools now, a parent will move from this school to this school. So it's the child's progress that we have to measure, not the schools. One of the schools in District 23, Jonathan Dill's school, is doing some unbelievable work.
Correct.
But every year he loses a certain number of kids because either parents move or other issues. And yet you have one of the most outstanding schools, Nadia Lopez's school there, who just was the Nobel Prize winner
Correct.
Of education.
Yes, you're right.
So what we need to do, and this is something, you know, District 13 asked me last night too, we need to start rebranding our schools. All of you need to go out there and talk about the great stuff that's happening in your local schools, Because if a school had a reputation 5 years ago, it still has the same reputation now when it's not necessarily the same school. So we need to do a lot more work about highlighting public education. I mean, one of the things we're doing with Mayor Levin, we're going to send some of the people to go see what's happening in some of the schools, like a Mark Twain. How do you replicate the good stuff? But how do we celebrate the stuff that's working that nobody knows about?
Yes, Chancellor. And I just want to finish up on, with the campus, we're focusing on technology and wellness. And what we're noticing in the community renewal schools, we have the computer labs, but no one to teach coding. And we know that coding and technology is the way to go in the future. And so I just look forward to working with the Department of Education. But then the second part of that, I have some schools where 23% of the kids come from homeless shelters. But there's only $100 per child additional funding. The question is, how do we guidance counselors are great, but we need social workers and psychologists in those schools, because coming out of a shelter, you can have depression, anxiety, so many different mental illnesses, just the traumatic effect of being homeless. So I just wanted to find out if we're going to put a mental health percentage for children coming from shelters, children whose parents are incarcerated, children who are chronically absent. So we know the catchment area, the pool of students who are at risk. And I just think we should be putting more resources at that risk population overall to make it happen. And as we know right now, Brownsville has a lot of children who go to school who wind up incarcerated. And we know now that Rikers Island has more people with mental disabilities than any other mental health facility in the state. So we have people who need mental help in a debilitating environment, not getting the help they need. And it all stems from the classroom, not saying from the classroom, but identifying these kids at an early age. And so that's why I'm really pro on mental health. I'm really pro on Thrive NYC to change the system in that we get these kids help at an early age.
Well, let me just say three things quickly. In this budget, there is, depending on the number of homeless students, there's an uptick in schools' budgets to be able to deal with that issue in a different way. So that's number one. Number two, when it comes to Rikers, after my second visit there, we embarked on creating a committee to make major changes. So for example, a year ago on Rikers, and I'm talking about the teenage center, more or less the middle school and high school part, the students were only in school 3 hours a day. Well, what do you do the rest of the time? So we increased the time for those students to 5 hours a day. We created a professional development plan for all the teachers. We now have what we call a master principal in that site. We actually purchased books, and I did that on a personal level because I'd gone to visit a school where all the books were on social justice issues and the kids couldn't read them fast enough. So we purchased books specifically so they would want to read them and take them back to their cells and read them there, because they weren't allowed to carry books from one place to the other. So we worked with Commissioner Ponte. We developed a whole new system, and I'm very proud. We could do a lot more, and we need to do a lot more. The other thing I'll say, that the pre-K initiative, And again, thanks to the First Lady, is also focusing on parenting skills. Once a month, we have parents come to pre-K centers and also to community centers to learn how to read to your child, how to work to your child, how to talk to your child. Because in a lot of communities, there's a sense of hopelessness that really people then don't do the next step. So how to have parents support groups for each other is something we're working on. But once again, I do think that in terms of how we encourage parents, we're encouraging mommy and me classes in right. Some of the schools and some of the neighborhoods where there's space. Three-year-olds, come with your child, learn how to read to your child. We're doing that in Red Hook at PS 15. Mommy and me classes. So there's a lot of things we're trying to do. But I think the most important thing, and I certainly give the First Lady, is saying the words out loud.
Right.
Because this was something nobody talked about.
Right.
They had all kinds of euphemisms. You know, he doesn't act right, or he's a little strange, or, you know, his grandfather had this. And now we're able to say out loud, this is what it's called, and this is what you need to do about it. We're working with a lot of hospitals. A lot of hospitals come forth to help us with this.
So just to finish real quick, key point, that yes, literally the pre-K teachers are being trained in how to identify the problems and start to get the help. And what we're trying to create is a dynamic where any principal, any teacher knows where to turn when they identify a child with a need, that could be that seamless. But I remind you again, we put, as I mentioned, the $10 million directly into, you mentioned the homeless kids, directly into the tutors and the attendance support in the shelter. We're putting social workers into 43 schools that have a high shelter population, so we're adding additional 33 new social workers to work with kids, to get to try and identify those problems that come out of homelessness, and the overall investment we're making in mental health throughout the school system. So, look, and your point about Rikers is well taken. Much more mental health oriented programming and going on there than ever before. But what we're trying to do, and I know you believe in this, is actually identify the mental health issues that lead people into the criminal justice system and stop them from ending up in the criminal justice system to begin with. This is going to be work of years, but I can safely say already we're starting to see some impact of being able to keep people out of the criminal justice system because they're getting the mental health care they need, and certainly on Rikers, because we have to worry about recidivism, getting people actual rehabilitation that can only happen if they're getting proper mental health services.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Chancellor. And I look forward to continuing working with you. You're doing a great job.
Thank you.